Hello, true believers. This is Doc Hogg, and welcome to episode 39 of Comics and Variety. If you like this channel, please do subscribe, hit the notification bell to be notified about new videos, and for the sake of YouTube's search algorithm, please do hit the like button. Now, before I get to Soulbound, I want to take a minute or two to let my viewers know about some of the pictures that flow across the screen in the CNV intro. Not going to do all of them today. For the sake of time, I'll save some for later episodes. But the first are these four, and these are of my son Charles, who I love pretty much more than, not pretty much, indeed, who I love more than life itself. The first one here is probably in late 2017 when he was around 20 months old or so. A few months earlier, I'd introduced him to McDonald's and he took to cheeseburgers pretty quickly. These other ones are more recent. He loves superheroes. In fact, one of the ways I used to get him to brush his teeth was to reward him with a few minutes of an Iron Man or Hulk movie after, you know, he finished brushing. The Batman cap he received from his Aunt Cecilia, and this photo is from last January. We were out in the snow at night, and I took a few photos on my camera, and it was just kind of a lucky accident. One of those photos came out just about as perfect as possible. Okay, let me talk about just two more photos here, two that are relevant for this episode. These two are from Soulbound by Paula Richey, and I think that's a good way to get into my review of the Soulbound comic book. Soulbound is an epic fantasy comic, and I'm not a huge fan of epic fantasy. You know, Lord of the Rings is about as far as I will go into that genre, and I mean the movies, not the books. That said, Richey has the beginning of a very good comic book here. One thing I like is that she is going to tell this story in 10 parts, and she isn't skimping on pages. Issue 1 has 28 pages. I don't like the current trend of telling a big story in six issues with 20 to 22 pages per issue, like War of the Realms. Richey isn't rushing it, and in my opinion, that is the right thing to do, especially when issue one is so tightly constructed. She tells the origin of the main character, Becca, and in doing so, she establishes that there is this other realm. Here is Becca's mom in a town between nations called Innick and Caldera. She's the pregnant one sitting on the left, and she is later chased by some creature, lands in a lake that transports her to our world. She is rescued by whom I assume is Becca's adoptive dad. Then we fast forward to Becca being in college. She is waking up from this nightmare. Some sort of evil female being is torturing some poor creature in shackles. Now, it's important. Pay attention to this page because we will come back to it. And there will be a quiz at the end. From there, we learn that Becca's dad has died, and at the funeral, we see Becca's stepmom. Now, stepmom, there's a trope that says wicked, right? Anyway, the stepmom is wearing a necklace that belongs to Becca and once belonged to Becca's mom. So after her dad's funeral, she returns to her dad's house to fetch the necklace. Now when she gets to the house, Becca finds that her stepmom has changed the locks. And that, I think, is a nice little extra touch to set up what is probably going to be a big conflict between Becca and the stepmom. I say that because the stepmom looks an awful lot like the evil being in the nightmare. Now, am I 100% sure of that? Eh, maybe closer to 95. The eyes are the same, the nose looks similar, but the chin comes to a much more prominent point in the stepmom picture. But if I have to bet money, I'd say that they are the same character. Okay, so Becca finds a way to get into the house, and she retrieves the necklace. She then gets back in her car, and the brakes go out, and she crashes into the lake. She's about to drown when a hand reaches down and pulls her out. And that's how issue one ends, with Becca realizing that, you know, it isn't Toto who pulled her out of the water, because she ain't in Kansas anymore. The creature that rescued her is the same from the nightmare. You have the talon-like nails on the hands, and there are the shackle abrasions on his wrists. And that's really a good ending to this to issue one. It really leaves you wondering, okay, what happens next? Overall, this is a very tightly constructed story. Richey has done very well here. She goes from the origin story that begins in the fantasy realm and then moves us to our realm, then to the conflict, and then to the main character ending up back in the fantasy realm. And I'll just say that I'm really looking forward to issue two. Alrighty, that music means that it is time for Hogg's Headlines, all the news that Doc Hogg wants to report on. Dateline, do you have the Peter Tingle?
In the latest issue of Friendly Neighborhood Spider-Man, Peter Parker comes home to see the gay guy who is camping out in his apartment. Well, I don't want to spoil it for you, so here's the page so you can read it yourself.
How lucky can one guy be? I kissed her and she kissed me. Like the fella once said, ain't that a kick in the head?
You know what, folks? I don't think I ever need to read comic books again. I mean, when I first started reading comic books as a kid, this was exactly the type of scene that I was looking for. And my life is complete. It has all the meaning it needs, at least as far as comic books go. So why should I ever have to read another comic book again? Dateline, interesting but not surprising. Marvel writer Saladin Ahmed, who is currently writing Miles Morales' Spider-Man, did an interview recently with Salon in which he claimed politics are central to the story for me.
You mean shoving politics in your face is what the writers at Marvel and DC are all about these days? That said, the full quote from Mr. Ahmed is actually kind of insightful. He said, quote, politics are central to the story for me. If I want to understand a character, I need to know how they grew up. I want to know what they expected out of life. I want to know whether they achieved that. You don't know those things unless you as a writer know the social and political landscape. That's the reality that we're writing about. This is central to writing a good story and believable, compelling characters.
This is interesting in two ways. One, it's simply wrong. I mean, there have been many, many great storytellers through the ages that have ignored the political and/or social landscape. I mean, Jane Austen comes to mind. Pride and Prejudice and many of her other books completely ignored the politics of the time, and yet they are great stories that actually do get at what the characters want out of life and how they go about getting it. Second, I really think it's a look into the mind of a social justice warrior. Social justice warriors want something political out of life, and they project that onto everyone else. They assume that everyone else wants something political out of life. That if someone wants to grow up to become, and later in their teenage years they want to become an auto mechanic, well, that's got to have something to do with the political and social landscape. Now, frankly, I don't think most people do that. I think someone who grows up and, hey, I want to work on cars for a living because Donald Trump is in the White House, said probably no one ever. But that is how SJWs look at the world, and lucky for us, they're forcing that view of the world down our throats in comic books all the time. Alrighty, that's all for now. Until next time, have a very nice day.
I kissed her and she kissed me. Like the fella once said, ain't that a kick in the head?